Actually, my ambition is to give several talks in one, and therefore it's going to be some kind of a meta talk. I will only describe what we were doing, and we'll count it as an oral presentation, if you allow. Okay, so in general, I guess everybody is noticing that the problem of emotional AI becomes not only very hot, but maybe central in these days. And the question is, how do we implement it? So there are multiple approaches, and so far there is no general solution. People just think of neural networks that can do it all, but so far didn't figure out how to train them. Okay, so let's think about the alternative, which is a cognitive approach based on cognitive architecture. Let's say we have a cognitive architecture of some sort, including memory systems, the cognitive cycle, and so on. How do we add emotions to it? We just heard yesterday, of course, we can add attributes like appraisals to every symbolic representation or any representation, and based on them, we can decide how the system should behave. And we use the semantic space, which becomes a semantic map if you allocate representations in it, which can be two-dimensional, three-dimensional, depending on our needs. Okay, but is this the whole story? How about social relationships? How about complex and social emotions like shame, envy, jealousy, pride, sense of humor, compassion, you name it. So are these just extra dimensions on the map, or would they require some kind of new apparatus to describe? I would rather accept the latter, and I propose that in addition to this affective space or semantic map, we also need another construct, which I call a moral schema. And so together with semantic maps, those moral schemas will explain the nature of our higher complex and social emotions. And let me now briefly explain you what is the idea of this moral schema. For this, I will use a silly example of a queue in which there are three people waiting to get on the airplane, for example. And they know each their place in the queue, and therefore they formed a sort of hierarchy, which is shown on the plot on the right side. Now, these F characters represent what it is supposed to be, but that may not be the fact what it is. So let's say somebody is trying to get ahead of the line, and so the order will be destroyed. Therefore, people who took this original order as normal will take certain actions to restore the order. And this is, in essence, the idea by which every moral schema works. So the idea is that there is a certain state of affairs that people decide to consider normal, and any deviation from the norm would require action that restores or tries attempts to restore the norm. And you can think of it as an agent on its own, which has its own goals, means, and its effect would be reduced to a bias in decision making. So let me show on this diagram. The input information that comes to the brain creates some kind of moral or cognitive appraisals, what is good, what is bad, including other dimensions. But there are also internal feelings And those are parameters of the moral schema. That's my definition of a feeling. That's what a person believes the thing should have as its characteristic in terms of appraisal. And comparing to the real appraisal derived from behavior, the schema would detect a difference, and therefore, if there is a discrepancy, then it would produce a bias in decision making in order to remove or reduce that discrepancy. In parallel with appraisals, there is another factor like somatic marker or physiological factor that takes similar effect, but it is in a sense parallel and maybe even contradictory with appraisals, but in some cases it can complement, in some cases it can compete. So together they work and produce bias in behavior, produce emotional feelings, emotional states, and the result is behavioral actions as well as involuntary expression on the face or in other physiological parameters. That's the general idea. The cycle of this moral schema, the life cycle, consists in its activation, then its normal operation when it works just like I described so far. When the conflict or discrepancy becomes substantially large, then the schema itself may need to undergo transformation to another state, which would be consistent with the present situation. And certainly there would be other mechanisms resulting in its deactivation, which I'm not going to describe right now. So this is a general framework, and if we think now of the whole architecture of an agent, it basically has two or three factors that work in parallel. One is rational, when the agent follows its plans, trying to accomplish goals and so on. Another is cognitive, and the third is somatic. The second and the third may be described by the constructs like the moral schemas. So when those moral schemas are undergoing certain activation and their characteristics take values on the semantic map, those values correspond not to primitive anger, fear, or joy, but to higher emotions. That's my sense of a difference between lower and higher emotions. When the moral schema becomes involved, then it becomes higher emotion. Okay, so then we can go further and think of a narrative intelligence in which the architecture is divided in several levels and has the capacity to build the story of everything happening in the world, finding possible narratives of development of events, finding its own place in it, and deriving the goal for itself, and making a plan, and then performing according to that plan at the lower level. Okay, so this is the story in a nutshell, very briefly. But now, what can we do in terms of specific implementations? We had several of them so far, like virtual listener, which was listening to a story together with real human, and the task for participant was to distinguish between the human and the virtual entity. Here you see those two faces at the lower left corner, one controlled by human, another by automaton. Another paradigm that we implemented was a virtual dancer. This is an early implementation. The third was a virtual pet, a penguin, and so on. These are snapshots from the penguin game. And in all these cases, we also have virtual dance partner. In these cases, we have a rather sophisticated agent implemented according to the principles that I just described, or at least part of them, and interacting with the human. The goal was to validate this model and show that it works, which elements are important, so on. These are, for example, data collected from the virtual dance partner during the experimental study. I don't have time to go through this. We also had implementation of virtual clowner in this case, without visualization, but just machine was writing the narrative of what is happening on the stage when two clowns perform. And those clowns were, of course, agents controlled by this architecture that we call e-biker. Okay, so you remember from the previous year our virtual convention center. We are still going to use it, don't worry, in the poster session. And here's our poster presenter. We are still working on it. And here is not our work, but maybe a direction of our future development in intelligent tutoring systems, which involve multimodal interaction between a student and the computer. So having all this, the question is, so what? How do we measure the result? How do we validate success? And do we know what the goal is after all? Well, we see that today virtual assistants are very far from what people would expect from them. And part of the problem is that we cannot quantify the difference. So we need precise metrics. We need a measurement device that will tell us the distance to the goal and tell us, therefore, how to improve the artificial intelligence. One problem is that to measure human likeness or psychological characteristics of an agent, we cannot subject it to tests like we would administer those to human participants, like Big Five, Cattell test, and so on. So instead, what we can do is put the human and the robot in a virtual environment and let them interact, collect the logs of their interactions, and then observe some correlation between those psychological tests and logs, and therefore learn how to psychologically profile a human based on his or her behavior in the computer game. And then we can apply the same procedure to the robot, of course. So these are, for example, parameters derived from the Cattell test. And imagine those parameters can be measured for the robot. And this is what we are currently working on. There are several already results that we have and ideas where to go, but we hope that it is possible to predict how this virtual agent or robot can be perceived by humans based on analysis of those logs. Okay, so I don't have time to tell you the nice bottom line. Well, this is basically our direction, and yeah, to conclude, I should say this is still the most important topic in AI, I believe, how to make virtual agents socially acceptable. And there are like several possible scenarios of their development, and we want them to develop in accordance with ourselves, to make them human-like. And this is the challenge that we all face now. Okay, I shall stop now. Sorry, I am 3 minutes over the time limit. Okay, any questions? Maybe one comment? Oh, Rosario is here. Please. Who wants to say something? Or if you don't have time, you can ask me during the discussion panel. Okay. Now I guess I fulfilled my duty and I shall transfer the screen to Taisuke. Are you ready?
Okay.